Well, what difference would it make in your life if, by the way you lived your life, you could actually please God? What difference would it make in your life, if, by the way you worked and rested and talked and walked and loved and served, if by doing those things you could actually please God? Not please God in the sense of helping God to feel better or happier than he otherwise would. Our God is infinite in gladness. No human can add to his joy nor detract from it. We don't please God in the sense of giving him something that he doesn't already possess. Nor do we please God in the sense of merit, the sense of earning something from God. Our God has no needs. He's not served by human hands. No human has ever done God a favor. So we don't please God in the sense of meriting something from him. But do we, could we, by our words and by our thoughts and by our actions, imperfect and impure as we are, could we actually please God? Please God in the sense of evoke God's perfect pleasure, stir up God's infinite delight, draw out God's everlasting smile. Could we actually please God in that sense? God says we can. That's why Paul prayed that the Colossians would walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him. Colossians 1:10. Why Paul sought to speak not to please man, but to please God. 1 Thessalonians 2:3 and 4. Why family members in the New Testament are to show godliness to their own household, for this is pleasing in the sight of God. 1 Timothy 5:4. Why Christian citizens, like you and me, are to lead peaceful and quiet lives, godly and dignified in every way, for this is pleasing in the sight of God. Brothers and sisters, God tells us in his word that we can please him, that we can evoke God's perfect pleasure. And the fact that we can should drive us to want to do so with more and more and more and more of our lives, should make us want to say along with Paul that whether home or away, we make it our aim to please God, 2 Corinthians 5:9. That as with Hebrews, we will not neglect to do good and to share what we have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God, Hebrews 13:16. That as good soldiers, you and I, good soldiers of Christ Jesus, we will share in suffering, for no soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him, 2 Timothy 2:3 and 4. Church, do you believe this morning that God is not indifferent to the way you live your life? That God is not only able to ever frown or grimace over your life, but no other emotion other than that? But instead, that God has capacity and desire to take pleasure in the way you live your life. Now, without faith, if you're not a believer, it is impossible to please God. Hebrews 11:6 tells us so. But with faith, you can please God. In fact, if you are a Christian, I'd venture to say that you have likely already done so more times in your life than you might dare to imagine. So my exhortation to you this morning is that you would revel in the pleasure of pleasing God. That you would, out of that pleasure of pleasing God, seek to please God all the more with more and more and more and more of your life. you long to draw out that pure and pleasing smile that we will gaze upon for all of eternity and forevermore. Let's pray. Father, we, as your people, we want to be pleasing to you. We want to be delightful in your eyes. We want to be a beautiful bride for your son. We want to live lives that exalt you in this world, that make much of you in this world. And we want to believe by faith that every tiny little thing we do, in every tiny little movement, a thought, an action, and word, in all of those, we have potential, we have ability to please you. And big and small and everything in between, Father, we desire to. We confess that our desire is often not oriented that way, but towards self, that we tend to live in a world where we don't think of you as present and aware and and Father, we mourn over that fact. And we don't want to stay that way. And we want you to change our hearts. And so, Father, we confess this to you. And for all the other ways that we can think of that we have sinned, that we have fallen short this week, Lord, we bring them all to you right now in this moment of silent confession. Father, you are the one who dwells in perfect pleasure and joy and delight. We trust that with Christ over us, through our faith in him, you look upon us with delight. We ask, God, in trust, in faith, that you conform us more and more to his image each and every day we live this life. We pray in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. All right, church, this morning, as you're able, I want to invite you to stand now for the assurance of pardon. We have confessed our sins together, and so now I want you to hear the good news. God tells us in his word that when we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, to all who humbly seek the mercy of God, I say to you, in Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven.